September 10th, Miranda Lambert. September 23rd, Heart, Joan Jett and the Blackhearts, and Cheap Trick. And September 24th, Toby Keith. So some really, really cool shows coming up there. The Palm Beach Beer Fest is July 23rd. The Craft Beer Bash is August. It's coming up, but they don't have an exact date yet. That's at PGA National. Brew at the Zoo is coming up not too long at the Palm Beach Zoo. These are all really, really cool things going on, so I highly recommend that you check them out. And Discover the Palm Beaches is where you can find out more information about that. I think what we're going to do is we are going to take one more quick break, and then we're going to come back with our guest. That would be director Michael Manasseri from The Pickle Recipe. We're going to talk a little bit about the Palm Beach Film Festival, his premiere last night. And it is going to be showing again on Monday. So anybody that hasn't gotten a chance to see it will get their chance on Monday afternoon. That's April 11th. So what we're going to do is take one more quick break, and we'll be back with Michael. So stay tuned for more of the Golf and Travel Show.
Cinderella story, out of nowhere, a former greenskeeper now about to become the Masters champion.
It looks like I'm a wreck. It's in the hole!
I rap live, call me Drop It Thunder, and I got good two goal, four strokes under. Get out the way if you wanna go play, cause I give it my all every single day.
Have a lot of cash cause I sing my parts. Stacks and stacks cause I'm making the cuts. You can't fathom my
And space. We I'm are real. Back and time for one last message from our sponsor, Labor Finders. If your business needs industrial workers, or if you're looking for work, you gotta call Labor Finders. Labor Finders places for temporary or temporary to hire. For opportunities for skilled, semi-skilled, or general labor positions, such as for plumbers, electricians, concrete workers, forklift operators, office clerical workers, and much, much more. Labor Finders has almost 200 offices nationwide. Near here in Boca Raton, they have offices in Homestead, Miami, Fort Lauderdale, West Palm Beach, and in Jupiter. So if you need legal, insured, hard workers, or if you need some work, call Labor Finders. Toll free at 800-864-7749. That's 800-864-7749 or visit laborfinders.com. And that was Fish, a little dinner and a movie, and quite appropriate this time of year here in Palm Beach County, as it is the Palm Beach International Film Fest. It's going on right now. It will be going on through April 14th. Tons of interesting films, something for everybody. And last night was the premiere of a film that I was lucky enough to preview. Last week, I got a chance to take a look at it. Called The Pickle Recipe. A lot of fun for me, and I got a lot of laughs out of it, and I'm sure you would as well. And to find out a little bit more about the film, about the festival, about the premiere last night here in Palm Beach, director Michael Manasseri. Michael, are you with us?
Yes, I am. How you doing?
I'm doing great. First, let me apologize for not making it last night. I had hoped to, but something came up, so I could not. But I certainly want to find out from you what I missed, what our listeners missed, and maybe how they could at least catch up a little bit on Monday. So how did it go last night?
Sure. Well, it's okay that you couldn't come because we were pretty much sold out. it was a packed theater, and I have to say it was the warmest reaction we've gotten to the film thus far. It was really a wonderful experience, and we had a great time.
Well, congratulations. Now, the film, when was it completed, and was this the first time that it's been at a festival, or has it appeared at some other festivals previously?
The film was completed in January of this year, 2016, so we just finished it.
Okay.
And we were fortunate enough to have our world premiere at the Santa Barbara International Film Festival in February.
Mm-hmm.
And which was, again, a really wonderful experience. It's a terrific festival. And actually, when it was interesting because we were sitting on the beach, my wife and I and our and a fellow producer, writer, and we had just had our screening, I think, the night before. It was great. And while we're sitting on the beach, we got the email that we were selected into Palm Beach International Film Festival. So we had a great beach day that day.
Well, I'm sure. And I know it's exciting. And I know a little bit about these festivals. But for those who are listening, besides the obvious, whereby the people in the community have an opportunity to see all these films that they might otherwise not get to see, from somebody from your perspective, and I know that you also were one of the producers of the film, what's the purpose of these festivals and where does it take you? What are your goals or what are you trying to achieve by getting your film into these festivals?
Sure. Well, I mean, for independent film, obviously we're not studio. It's not a studio production. There's not mega millions of dollars behind the film, behind the marketing machine. So when you're making an independent film and if you're fortunate enough to know that you have an audience, which we do, it's a very, I think you've seen it, it's a sweet, heartwarming, laugh-out-loud, funny film and a family film. And, you know, for us being able to get into festivals, especially in the areas where we feel our film will eventually play very well when it's released, the festivals give us the ability to get a read on the film in the areas, you know, where we think our audience is. So it also helps us get, PR and marketing through the festival. So not only can we help the festival by bringing in patrons to them to have them experience the festival so the festival can grow, it helps us so when we eventually do release our film down the line, you know, there's an awareness that we've gotten in different communities, whether it's just through screenings themselves and word of mouth, which is really probably the most important type of marketing for this film, but also through local press, through shows like this, TV interviews, reviews, all of that can help an independent film down the line when it eventually does come out in theaters.
Yeah, and again, so obviously you would like to get a broader audience. You might get it in theaters, and I suppose there could be some, broader releases. There could be awards that you could win at these different competitions because they obviously
sure.
do judge all the films. So I guess there's a whole lot. And I suppose also one way or another, whether this becomes a huge hit and makes you millions or if it builds your resume and helps you maybe for your next film, perhaps, correct?
All of the above.
Mm-hmm.
All of the above. I mean, obviously you hope for the best. What you try not to do when you make an independent film, especially a comedy, when you're talking to people, you try not to bring up My Big Fat Greek Wedding, because that's the biggest success in independent film history.
Right.
And everybody wants to make a My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Okay, but things like that do happen more than just, I mean, to a, maybe not that big an extent, but obviously sometimes something gets discovered and you know,
correct.
Unexpectedly does take off, right? It can happen.
Sure. And those are that's the hope. That's the hope for even for our film. I mean, we, for Boca, Palm Beach in South Florida, we know that our film has an audience, and from the reaction last night when they were really rolling in the aisles, and they loved it, and it was so nice for us, for the filmmakers, to see it and experience it. So, you know, we do have, when we make an independent film, you have to be hopeful. I mean, you don't want to have unrealistic hopes, but you have to have high hopes and hope for the best and try to hit it out of the park. And for us, you know, our actors hit it out of the park. We were lucky enough to have Lynn Cohn, who plays Maga on Sex and the City, and she was in The Hunger Games, and David Paymer, who's an Academy Award nominee. So, I mean, we have high hopes, but we also know we've delivered a really funny, sweet, touching film, and that's the reaction we got last night, and I'm looking forward to showing it on Wednesday in Boca as well.
Well, you know, I had mentioned last week when I did a brief review that, you know, for me, it was funny and it was touching and there were some really cool parts. But the one thing that I appreciated more than anything, and I'm guessing maybe other people did, whether they conveyed it to you or not, was any time that I can use a Yiddish phrase, my mother is so proud of me. And it's very, very hard to carry that on. And it's very, very rare to watch a film where you can learn some additional Yiddish. So for me, it was worth it just for that alone. The other thing, of course, is that, you know, at least in my circles, we all have a booby that has a recipe of some sort. It may not be a pickle recipe, but to hear stories, I mean, you know, my father-in-law had his Passover noodles that he was able to make, you know, for the soup that were kosher for Passover, which, you know, I mean, everybody's got something like that. So at least in this community, there's something in the film for everybody that's going to kind of touch them in a special way, you know, for them, their own family, their own relatives. And so I think you're right when you find the right community. Now, but another thing that I thought was interesting, you know, I had read a little bit about the film and some comments from you that, you know, you were talking that you're not of the same nationality or background or religious persuasion, but how every nationality, that there are so many similarities between them when it comes to stories like this with the, you know, the grandmother and the recipe and whatever, mm-hmm. that for you, this was just natural, right?
Yes, absolutely. It's like you just said, if we're lucky enough to have warm, loving families that nourish us and raise us, so whether you're Jewish or Italian or Spanish or any ethnicity, I mean, for me, I'm Italian, and it was my grandmother's sauce and meatballs, and I remember Sunday dinners at my grandmother's house. I will remember them for the rest of my life. I mean, you know, from a very young boy until I became a man. And unfortunately, she's not with us anymore, but I'll always remember it. And as I, whether it's a pickle or meatballs, for me as an Italian, every time I go into an Italian restaurant, I hope I smell the smell of what my grandmother's kitchen was like. And some, it's gotten close, but it's never gotten there. But it'll be with me forever, just like your father's noodles will be with you forever. And that's what, you know, besides, you know, the funny and the comedy, there's that family element in the story that I think everyone can relate to.
You know, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, you're talking about that, and where I grew up in New York, you know, we the next town over was Syosset, and there was the restaurant where Billy Joel wrote his song, Scenes from an Italian Restaurant. It was that restaurant. And, you know, we all went there and we all felt that same feeling of, you know, relating to food and relating to family and ethnicity, and just very, very cool. So, you know, where do you go from here? I mean, what plans do you have now? Are there additional festivals that you think you'll be going to? Is this going to end up being released somehow, whether it be in more theaters or digital somehow? Where's the future for this particular film?
Sure. Well, the immediate future is Monday at 1:10 at the Cinemark Palace in Boca.
Yep. No, absolutely.
And then, and then in Los Angeles, in next month, we will be at the Los Angeles Jewish Film Festival. I think it's one of the largest Jewish film festivals in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And the way it's looking now is, since we're having such a wonderful festival circuit experience, I think we're going to be utilizing the festivals for the next few months.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and then we're going to put it out in theaters. We're going to put it out in select theaters. We think it will play to theater audience, you know, people who still go to the movies, because there are a lot of people who don't. But we think our audience still goes to the movies. They want to see it in the theater. And that's what we're going to go for. We're going to go for that here in South Florida and select cities across the country. And then after that, I do expect it to have a long life, digital and television life down the line. I expect 5 years from now to be traveling somewhere on an airplane, and the movie will be there.
I'll probably see it as well. But I have a question for you. So, I mean, we talk about, you know, the fact that people still like to go to the theater. We talk about, you know, digital. You know, I've listened to so many musical performers who say that, you know, the digital thing has just changed their world. Now they got to go out on tour to make money. From your perspective as a filmmaker, the digital revolution, I mean, horrible? Have you adapted to it? How has it affected you and the way you think of things now for your business?
In this business, at least for me, I've had to adapt, and it's been a good thing to adapt. As an independent filmmaker, before there was such a small opening that you had to get through if you wanted to reach a certain successful point. And it used to be that if you were on demand or you went to DVD, that, you know, maybe 10, 15 years ago, that was a sign of failure. Whereas now the digital space is where almost everyone wants to be. And again, like I said, we do think our movie is a theater movie first. But for independent filmmakers, the fact that there are so many options now, viable options where either you can A, make money on your films, and B, get exposure. You know, where now, if you're lucky enough to get on Netflix or on iTunes, where maybe 10,000 people would have seen your film, a million people can see your film.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, in a monetary, you know, when you're talking about just money, that helps, as well as exposure and experience. And if you're trying to build your resume as a director or a producer, you know, it's certainly helpful.
So the industry has evolved, and you're evolving with it.
Absolutely. I think we all have no choice.
Exactly. I think so. So one more time, The Pickle Recipe, a fun film. I enjoyed it tremendously. You can catch it Monday, April 11th at 1:10 p.m. at the Cinemark Palace here in Boca Raton. For more information, you can also, or buy tickets, you could go to pbifilmfest.org, and you can also find out about all the other independent films that you might want to check out as well. If we don't support these kinds of events and festivals, they go away. So I encourage everybody to go out there and support it. And I do want to thank you, Michael Manasseri, for joining us and just a little bit of insight into your business and these film festivals and independent filmmaking and, of course, The Pickle Recipe.
Thank you so much. Glad to be here.
Thank you. Congratulations. All right. What we're going to do is we're going to take one final break. I still got a bunch of deals for you, a little bit of travel news. If we can squeeze it in, you don't want to miss it. So stay tuned for more of the Golf and Travel Show. We'll be right back.
If you go away on this summer day, then you might as well take the sun away. All the birds that flew in the summer sky.
And we are back. And yeah, if you want to go away, this, you're probably listening to the right place, because we got places where you can go and some deals that you can get. And we'll save a couple of more deals for the very, very end. Let's give you a little bit of travel stories and some news and things that I've been following. First of all, interestingly enough, I got an email just before I came on the air from the CEO of Marriott. And that was because I am a member of their rewards program. And he was just commenting on what we've been reporting on for weeks about the back and forth between the acquisition for Starwood, between them and the Chinese company that they were bidding against. And first of all, I also heard on the news now that the Chinese company, they had backed out. They were the high bidder and then retreated. And come to find out that Mr. Marriott, he said Bill Marriott, that would be the CEO, he said that they were not going to beat it. They were done. They were out of the bidding. So they kind of backed into the big prize. But, what was nice about it was, is he was explaining to not worry about changes to the program. He was, setting the stage and the parameters. He was, putting his cards on the table. It seems today, the shareholders approved it. So they're moving forward in this merger. Could get approved and start happening by mid-year. But, of course, with any large merger like that, when you have programs like they have and they're the size of the two companies that they are, they're probably going to run independently for a while, and it probably will take a while, perhaps a year or more, before they're totally merged together. But Marriott was explaining that it's good news, of course, because, well, now they'll have so many more properties once they're all together. And what they are trying to do is take the best features of both programs and combine them so that the program is more robust. And they're also going to reach out to their members to ask for additional suggestions at this time, as long as they're making all these changes, so that they can make it as robust as possible. It's obviously extremely competitive out there. They understand that their most loyal customers are the ones that are members of these programs. And from what I could see, they seem to be doing the right thing for us. Which I hope is that way, because typically mergers also result in less competition and higher prices. So I'm hopeful that this will be a good thing for all of us consumers of travel, and it remains to be seen, but it's a good start to be upfront, open, and to say that you're trying to make improvements and to ask for the feedback from their customers. So for the time being, kudos to Marriott for that. Another big player in the hotel business is a name that you probably hear maybe a little bit more often than you might like, at least many of you, and that would be Trump Hotels. And they certainly have a major presence here in South Florida. And it seems that they are being investigated for possible payment card breach. And the Secret Service and the FBI are investigating this. It's the second time in less than a year. And it seems that some of the bad guys out there don't like Trump, and probably a lot of the good guys out there don't like him either. So anyway, I thought that was kind of interesting. Another story that we've been covering for the past week or so is the Virgin America potential acquisition, and it seemed that they had two suitors. It was going to be either Alaska Airlines or JetBlue. Either of which have decent reputations, if not good reputations, all three of them actually. You know, quite a change from some of the other mergers where you take two really bad companies with really bad service and you make a much bigger bad company instead of two smaller bad companies. I don't know why they always think when you take two bad companies and you put them together, you're going to get something better. It's just not possible. But in this particular case, the winner is Alaska Airlines. They have agreed to merge. They're calling it a merger, but I do believe that they'll fly under the Alaska Airlines banner. And Alaska Airlines has been known to have very, very good service. I have never flown them. Unfortunately, where I fly to, they just don't have that many flights. So it will give us here on the East Coast probably an opportunity or a better opportunity to give Alaska Airlines a try. So I wish them well. And again, I'm a little bit concerned. Another merger, another opportunity to jack up the prices. And hopefully that won't be the case. These are respectable folks that are merging, and let's hope that they do the right thing. Speaking of which, I did see a recent report in the news about some of the surveys about airline quality. It was the 2016 Airline Quality Rating Report, which was released. And it's came out of one of the people who wrote it was from Wichita State University. Give them the appropriate credit. And it seems that the airline industry, as far as on-time performance and luggage, they seem to be improving a little bit, according to this study. I have not experienced that, so I don't know what they're talking about. But they did call out a couple of people in particular for on-time arrivals. The best airline was Hawaiian. The worst was Spirit. For denied boardings, the best was JetBlue. The worst was Envoy. I'm not familiar with them, so I can't speak about them. Mishandled bags, best was Virgin America, worst was Envoy again. Customer complaints, the best or the fewest complaints was Alaska. So as I said, they're good. The worst, Spirit. So we got Spirit up there in a couple of the categories as far as being really bad. No surprise whatsoever there. Here's an interesting story, something that I recently on two occasions had an opportunity to look out my window and see, and that was at the Wynn Hotel, their beautiful golf course, Tom Fazio Wynn Golf Club, just absolutely gorgeous. Love the view. Have not had the chance to play it. It's, I think, about $500 or $600, unless you're a high roller, and it's going away. This beautiful golf course is just going away. I hate to say it. But it seems that Steve Wynn, who is an avid golfer, is going to turn this beautiful golf course into a $1.6 billion lake resort that's going to have a whole water park, it seems, in there as well. And Wall Street likes it because they claim that it will increase their profitability tremendously, that the golf course, maybe because nobody could afford to play on it anyway. But in any event, it's just a shame because it's just so beautiful, that golf course. So I'm a little bit sad as a golfer, but it is Las Vegas, and money is what drives everything in Las Vegas. So what are you going to do? Here's a cool event. just not too far down the road from Savannah, a city that I like to visit is Tybee Island. It's maybe a 20 or 30 minute or so drive east of historic Savannah, Georgia. And they've got a bunch of festivals coming up. So not too bad of a drive from the folks listening here in Florida. If you want to get away for a little festival, whether it weekday or weeknight, they've got the Tybee Wine Festival coming up. And it begins on April, it runs April 20th through the 24th. So starts midweek and runs through the weekend. Within the festival, things like the Art of Pairing on Thursday the 21st, an evening of oysters and wine. That's like right up my alley, but that's on Friday, April 22nd. I'll be here talking to all you. The Grand Wine Tasting is Saturday, April 23rd, and the Champagne Brunch is on Sunday, April 24th. You would do pretty well for yourself if you maybe combined a visit with downtown historic Savannah along with this festival in Tybee Island. You kind of get the best of both worlds, and I like Savannah. It's just a really cool place. Great restaurants, beautiful squares, you know, parks in these squares. Just really, really nice. And if you'd like to find out a little bit more information about this, you can visit TybeeWineFestival.com. That's T-Y-B-E, WineFestival.com. And you can get all the details. And sounds like a lot of fun to me. I've got two more deals for you before we run out of time. I've been saving them. And, you know, we spoke a little bit about Europe, a place that I visit often. And, anytime I can, I mean, I lived there for a long time, but I still go back a lot. But it can be very expensive. A brand new Renaissance Hotel just opened in Midtown, New York. It's in the Garment District. Very, very cool designs. I mean, incredibly cool designs. They actually, the lobby, it changes based upon you. It's got like this electric eye that watches you. It senses your temperature, and the whole mood of the lobby just changes. I have no idea how they did it. But right now, weekend rates, Thursdays through Sundays, starting at only $200. And Renaissance is in the Marriott family, so you can also get your Marriott rewards points. It just opened last month. It's they have a rooftop patio bar with views of the Empire State Building, which is very, very cool. Found this on Travelzoo, and it does not have a expiration date on this one, but they sell out really quick. And I got time for one last deal for you. Miami to Lima, Peru. Airfare nonstop on LAN, L-A-N Airlines, which is highly regarded, one of the most highly regarded from South America. Only $498 from July 15th through now through July 15th or August 8th through December 9th. And again, I found this on Travelzoo. This deal does expire on April 11th, so you have precious little time. If you would like to go to Machu Picchu, or check out Lima, $498 round trip, you really can't beat that, especially on a good airline. What I want to do is one more time thank our guest, Director Michael Manasseri from The Pickle Recipe. You could check that out on Monday, April 11th at 1:10 p.m. at the Cinemark Palace in Boca Raton. Go to pbifilmfest.org for tickets or to find out more information about that show as well as all the others. We will be back again next week, same time, same place, for more of The Golf Channel. Check us out on Facebook.com/ The Golf and Travel Show. We'll talk to you next week. And every stop is neatly planned for a poet and a one-man band. Homeward bound, I wish I was. Homeward bound. Home, where my thoughts escape in home, where my music's playing home, where my love lies waiting silently for. You have been listening to The Golf and Travel Show, hosted by Dan Chu. Heard live every Friday, 7 to 8 p.m. on 1470 WWNN, and replayed every Sunday from 6 to 7 p.m. on 740 a.m. WSBR. Visit the show on Facebook and tune in next week. If you are in South Florida or traveling the world, hit 'em straight. The opinions expressed on the following sponsored program are strictly those of the host, guests, and callers, and not necessarily those of this station, its staff, management, or sponsors. Me and my old lady ain't been getting along. Things don't get better. I'll soon be long gone. This situation is driving me insane. Somebody touch my
For many Americans, owning your own business is a dream come true. And many business owners rely on help from others to reach their potential. That's where SCORE comes in. With more than 12,000 volunteers ready and willing to help businesses succeed.
SCORE is a nonprofit organization where we provide free business consulting services to people who want to start a business already in business.
For nearly 50 years, SCORE mentors have been helping businesses get off the ground, achieve their goals, and realize their dreams.
What's even better than dreams is making a dream come true.
Come join us and help tomorrow's business success stories unfold today. Your advice and expertise can make all the difference in the world.
I believe one person.